This is the nitrogen cycle. Universally hated. Questions can be quite complicated. This is really not as bad as most teachers make it out to be. Okay, so I'm going to start with a series of four boxes connected by arrows along the top. This is going to be the direction of flow, pretty much, and it should all make a little bit more sense. So let me draw the boxes first. So far, so good. These are squares that are going to represent inorganic. So if you don't know what that means, it means not containing carbon, the inorganic forms of nitrogen that flow through ecosystems. I'm going to start here with the letter A, easy to remember. The difficult thing often about these questions in the exams is that they will always give you a different diagram, and it's always going to look slightly different. Every textbook's going to represent it differently. I would have your version, i.e., my version, in your head, crystal clear. You'll see that it's not that difficult. And know what's what in terms of the scene. Sometimes they're going to skip steps, sometimes they're going to change the layout. But if you're confident of what's where in your head, then you can remap the question so that it makes sense to you. And I always start here with A. So this is ammonium ions. And ammonium ions, as I said, the direction of flow is going to be in this direction. Ammonium ions are going to be transformed into nitrite. This is an I, and what I usually do is write this underneath with a number one because it comes first. Because the next thing that comes after this is pretty similar, and you're going to have to spell them correctly because they are very easily confused. This is nitrate. And usually I put in here late. So nitrate comes after nitrite. We start with A at the beginning of the alphabet, nitrites, nitrates. And then the evil form that we do not want is nitrogen gas in the atmosphere. So this is very unreactive, inert. It's almost impossible for things to use. I might even put a little nasty cross in there because that's not what we want. That's not the form of nitrogen that biological things want nitrogen in. Okay, so what do we want nitrogen in? Well, the easiest form of nitrogen to absorb for plants are nitrates. So plants are going to absorb these things. So this is going to be plants. And you need to know which kind of compounds contain nitrogen in plants. Well, any living thing is going to have nitrogen-containing compounds in a couple of forms. I'm just going to put them in green. So see if you can guess what they are. Think, test yourself. They are proteins or amino acids. We can also have DNA or RNA. So these is often the inference of the question is about what do the biological ramifications of this mean in plants or animals. So I'm doing a circle around this. Circles are going to be organic life forms, so living things, basically, organic forms of nitrogen. Well, these are, I'm going to put this arrow in black actually, because this is not an arrow that you need to know in terms of, you're going to need to know the names of which of these. They're all going to have a name. In fact, this one is just absorption, not the most important. This one is going to be animals. How do animals get their nitrogen? Well, they eat plants. And where are the nitrogenous compounds in animals? Well, all living things. I'm going to repeat this a lot of times. Protein and DNA. Again, animals are living. They're going to go in a round circle. Okay, so what happens to the nitrogen compounds from animals and plants when they die, or maybe they excrete or egest these things? Well, they are going to be broken down by decomposers or saprobionts or saprobiotic bacteria, microorganisms. So this, in fact, I'm going to label all the stages afterwards. So I'm going to call these decomposers. And I'm going to add a little note to that. Saprobiotic microorganisms, microbes. Where do they have their nitrogenous compounds? Well, you guessed it, proteins and DNA. And are they living? Yes, they are. They go in a round bubble. Okay, so we're more or less done, and then we need to join the ends of the cycle, and we're going to add a few other little bits and pieces as well. But from here, we go back to ammonium. and there's a few other bits and pieces. But effectively, the cycle that we're most interested in as living things, we want to do this as much as possible. Or if we're an animal, we want to do this as much as possible. So what are the names of these stages? The names of these stages are, this one, we are the process of making ammonia. So this is ammonification. So fixation, the process of making ammonia. Pretty straightforward. These two both have the same name. These are nitrification. And this one, so this nitrification, because it's the process of making sort of good nitrogen, useful nitrogen. So nitrites and nitrates are soluble, they can be absorbed by plants, and they can do useful, fun stuff with them, like make proteins. This stage here, we're converting it back into a form of nitrogen that we don't want, the nitrogen in the atmosphere. And so we call this denitrification. We're removing nitrogen from the biological system. And the last stage that we need to learn about during this stage, oh no, there's two more, I'm lying to you. We're gonna go from nitrogen gas in the atmosphere straight into plants, but not everything can do this. Whenever we're taking nitrogen gas and converting it into a soluble form, so a plant, something that a plant can use, we're gonna call that nitrogen fixation. We're fixing it. We're taking it from a useless form and fixing it into a good form. Now, this is done, generally speaking, by bacteria in a mutualistic relationship with leguminous plants. So legumes, it's the French word for vegetables. An example of legumes are going to be pea plants, lentils, beans, things that vegetarians eat to get lots of protein. Why do they have lots of protein? Because they can do this. They can take nitrogen out of the air. They have a higher ratio of nitrogen in them, so they have a higher amount of proteins. And this is generally done by bacteria in the root nodules. Something else that I'm going to put in here about denitrification, the way that they tend to ask this in exam questions, this is nearly always under anaerobic conditions. And the way that question is usually asked is to do with how aerated the soil is or how waterlogged the soil is. That's how that question is usually asked. And the last stage that you need to know about is called saprobiontic nutrition. And well, this is going to be a key term. This is digestion or decay of dead organic matter by extracellular enzymes. Okay, so what is extracellular enzymes? Well, extra is outside of the cell. So these microorganisms basically ooze out their enzymes onto the substances. The enzymes catalyze the reactions, hydrolyze them, break them down into simple molecules, which can then be absorbed through the membrane. And this is how they do their digestion. So quick summary. Remember, you start with A. You go to nitrites because you could put an I in it. The second I, it can be a 1. Then it goes into nitrates. This is nitrification, making useful nitrogen. Soluble, it can be absorbed by plants. Where do plants, animals, and all living things have their nitrogen? In proteins and DNA, basically. This process is evil. It's denitrification. It's removing nitrogen from the biological system. It's under anaerobic conditions, and it's usually waterlogged soils. There are a magic group of bacteria that live in association with legumes, legume plants, which can fix nitrogen, nitrogen fixation, and convert the nitrogen gas. They actually convert it into ammonium ions, and then they do some fancy chemistry. But in terms of what you need to know, it's nitrogen fixation, and it's done by bacteria in association with legumes. How does it get recycled back into ammonium? Well, saprobiontic nutrition is basically digestion and decay by extracellular enzymes, and this process is ammonification. Okay, so we've done our summary, but there's one more thing that you need to know, and that's the names of the bacteria which do a couple of these processes, not all of them. So here, this bacteria that does this is called nitrosomonas. Nitrosomonas. You're just gonna have to learn these, but there is a little bit of a trick that we can use to remember these. So Nitrosomonas has more letters in it than this one. This is Nitrobacter. So we're going from long into short, and then this one here, nitrogen fixation, is done by, where am I going to squeeze him in? It's going to be done by rhizobium. So rhizome or mycorrhiza is something you're going to study probably as well. Rhizome means like root. So these live in the roots. That's a little bit of a clue in there. And then the last stage, that there's actually one that I'm going to add on for you lucky extra people, and it's another form of nitrogen fixation. And this form of nitrogen fixation, because we're going from nitrogen gas into ammonia, it's nitrogen fixation, is done by Azotobacter. These are bacteria that live in the soil. They do exactly the same as the rhizobium, but they don't do it in association with leguminous plants. Okay, so that is the full detail. There's not a huge amount of writing on that page. I suggest you write this out as a skeleton. So just the boxes and the arrows, no writing. Photocopy it. I might even get somebody to do that nicely and scan it and send it to me. So then you guys can print it out 10 times. It'll take you 2 minutes to fill that in once you get good at it, and you will not forget it. And then again, the key is just mapping the diagram they give you in the exam to the one you've got clear in your head, so that you know what's happening at each step of the way.